I want to welcome you to Dream Chasers Radio and Women's Talk right here with me, your host, Yaya Diamond. You can get us on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Spreaker, Spotify, TuneIn, Deezer, Vimeo, Roku, Amazon Fire, YouTube at Dream Chasers Radio, as well as Women's Talk, and so many different other places that I don't even remember. Okay, so I'm just going to say that because I don't remember. So, but we will be right back. Don't you go anywhere. Welcome back to the show. Man, we got a wonderful show for you today. You know, I love music. Well, it runs in my veins. Like I tell people, I have like eighth notes and tenth notes and you know, bass clef, and then the treble clef makes up my vein system. Like literally it's all in my body. All right. And so this next guest is an amazing host of her own show, and I want to welcome her. So welcome to the show, Terry Ferguson. What's
Yay!
Up?
How you doing? All right.
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm great. You know, awesome. I'm not going to complain. I'm just praying. You know, we got some good news for the election.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm praying that they work toward us getting the country back, getting people well, you know, and moving forward. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I know what you mean. I'm kind of like that kind of person that I really don't care. Just do your job.
Right. I agree.
Just do your job. Represent the people. Just represent the people. If you can't do that, hit the door.
Bye-bye.
So that's how I am. Yeah, definitely, definitely. So tell me about yourself.
Well, I come from the boogie down Bronx.
Sedgwick Avenue, Grand Concourse. Yo, right here.
That's the history of hip hop. Listen, yes. I take pride in that. You know, because I grew up, like, I would say I'm second generation hip-hop. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, after Flash and Bambaataa, Kool Herc, you know, as kids, we used to be out there DJing. Mm-hmm. In the streets, plugging, you know, the plugs into the lamp, street lamps.
I gotta show you something. So people that, hold on a second. People that are on the radio, if you're not looking at this on the video, mm-hmm. then you're missing out. So you need to go ahead and join us on YouTube. I loved what you were talking about the other day. You were talking about Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
Remember this?
Ooh, yes.
This is an actual record. Mm-hmm. I have that. And it's The Secret Life of Plants. And look at this.
Oh, I love that picture of Stevie.
Oh yeah, definitely. And I have the album. It's in here. Yes. I try not to kind of take it out, but it's a double.
Yes.
So how it's a double.
Yes.
And you were talking about Stevie, but not only that, girlfriend. Hold on, wait a second. I gotta find it. So I'm at the thrift store the other day. Hold on a second. I have to show you this because I know that you love history. I'm gonna move my chair out.
All right.
Hold on a second. Let me get this. Hold on.
Okay.
So I know that you know and you love, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so hold on a second. I have got to find this.
Okay.
Give me one moment. I am looking through this because I thought about it. I was like, wait a minute. I know I have this. I know she's going to speak about it.
Don't get me started because I can pull out some 8-tracks and cassettes and albums.
I got an 8-track player.
Listen, I have one too. I had one too.
What?
Listen, most of the early Stevie Wonder records we had albums were on 8-track, which I call the golden period for Stevie.
Oh, yeah.
Had on 8-track. Okay. Killer.
You've got to be kidding me. I have so many records that I know I have it in here. Give me one moment. I can't believe I can't find it.
Uh-oh.
No!
No!
You know how when you look up for something?
Yes.
And you can't find it? Okay. So here's another one.
Uh-oh.
And a lot of people don't know. This is history, dog.
Okay. History. Let's see this. Ooh.
Remember that?
Oh, my God. That's the collectors.
I know.
Hold on to that.
And you know, the thing is that it didn't come with a cover, but I wanted to get it because I wanted to at least collect it. It didn't come with a cover, and I bought it like this, so I keep it inside of this.
Oh, I got that album.
Yes, darling. Yes.
That's a classic.
And I keep it inside of here.
Yes.
Yep. Listen. Oh, wait, hold on a second now.
There's a song on the flip side, 45, of When Doves Cry.
I just knocked myself in the head with my own light.
Uh-oh, be careful. Uh-huh. 17 days.
Oh, but this is the collectors. You ready for this?
Okay. Uh-oh. Oh! Oh, my God.
You remember that?
Yes.
When they came out, it never got released.
Right.
Right.
You
so if you
that.
If
value.
You were a promoter,
you
got
right.
the
That's
promotion.
That's a promotional copy.
That's it right there. That's
absolutely.
It.
Listen.
That one. And this one.
Oh, yes. Is that
You guessed it. Hold on. She gonna be like freaking out. Hold on a second.
Wait a minute. You gotta
It's the red vinyl, baby.
You got to
with the picture.
You got those records from Colony Records, right?
I did. And yeah. Of course.
Not for sale. Yes. Demo.
You know what? You know who gave that to me?
Who?
Blue Notes, before they went out.
Oh.
Because most people don't know about Blue Notes. See, y'all don't know about Blue Notes. Y'all don't know about Blue Notes. Anyway, so. Wait, but I have got to show you this. Hold on a second. That's not what I wanted to show you. Being from the Bronx.
That's right.
Being from the Bronx means, give me a second, because I know what's in here.
Listen.
Being from the Bronx, you had that opportunity to get the original people.
So
I had to
listen. Oh, that's a classic.
That's my mom.
That's a classic.
That's my mom. My
really?
Mom's Evelyn Thomas.
Wow.
Yeah. So I had to actually bribe him to get this from him. Yeah, so
that's
a
classic.
I know.
Still burn that record. That record still gets burned.
I know. You know, that's one of the... girl, I got to find this. I got to show you this. Hold on a second. Now, see, I knew. I said, I'm going to be... I said to myself, you're not going to do this. But I'm going to do it.
Oh, my God. How you going way back?
Break it. You remember that movie?
I do. Yes.
Okay. That's one of them.
That's a classic.
I know you just trying to freak out on me.
Yeah, I'm bugging out.
We got to go.
You like me. You got crates? You have crates back there?
No, I actually have. It's down here. Okay, so hold on a second. Let me show you. Can you see?
Okay.
It's my collection. It's over here on this side.
I got mine in crates.
Yeah,
crates and boxes. Yeah.
No, I don't have crates, but I do have as a collection. Of just like I have Jimi Hendrix.
Oh, nice.
That's a collector.
That's good. Yeah.
I got the Michael Jackson.
Oh, listen. I'm going to tell you something. I bought that album, lent it to my girlfriend. Mm-hmm. She went to a party, they stole it.
What?
I was upset cuz I lent her some records, some 12-inch records. And then she bought me another copy of Thriller. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I was upset because that was a killer album.
What? Okay, wait, hold on. I got to show you this last one. I'm going to show it to you. Hold on, not this last one. Hold on.
Listen.
A friend of mine, I have to kind of, a friend of mine, he says, I know how much you love this person. Mm-hmm. And I want to give you this gift. He went to the concert of this person.
Right.
And he got this and he gifted it to me. It's one of my most precious, precious things. And I'm going to show you. It's not a record, but.
Oh, nice.
It's the Tina Turner.
Oh.
It's in here. It's got her legs, of course.
Oh, nice.
It's got the ticket. It's the nice. Booklet and very everything good. Of the concert she did back in the 80s.
Oh, that's a collector. Hold on to that.
No, ain't nobody hold getting that. That's going down in there.
Yeah.
But there is one more thing, girl. If I could find it, we're going to have to stop. You have to stop the whole thing. Just stop the whole thing. I got to find this.
Okay.
I just bought it too. People look at me and I'm talking to myself like, I can't believe it got this.
Uh-huh.
And my husband was like, you got what? I said, what? I got it. I got it, baby. I got it. So give me a moment to find it. Give me a second. Give me a second. Right. You got to give me a second. You got to.
You cracking me up.
Literally, I found it.
She said, where's this album? Where is it at? You know?
So, sorry.
Wait a minute.
Now you know what I'm getting ready to do. You know what I'm getting ready to do. The legendary.
Oh.
I got it right here. It is MGM Records.
Right. Oh, Tommy Edwards? Whoa. Mm-hmm.
It's an actual original. It's pasted onto here. And nice. It's the actual, you know how they had the pictures?
Yeah.
It didn't get signed.
Oh.
But it is his actual picture nice. That he had.
Oh.
And it's on here.
That's one of the songs, All in the Game. I mm-hmm. love when he sings that. Uh-huh. That's a beautiful song.
Child, honey, let me, hold
that's
on.
That's a
hold
beautiful
on.
Song.
Give me a second now. Let me close this up because it's just that good. Hold on.
Uh-oh, she got Tommy Edwards. Man, you got some stuff in there. All right.
Talk about history. I yes. knew it. I said, yes. watch. I can't wait for this one. I can't wait. Okay,
I
you ready?
12-inch.
You ready?
All right. You ready?
All right. Now, I'm going to have to wait. Hold on.
Wait.
Motown presents Prime Time.
Okay.
Performing TV themes the way you like to hear them.
Oh, wow. Nice.
It's a record of that, all what, of the TV songs.
Theme? Soul Train.
Back in the day.
Get out of here.
I'm not kidding you, girl. Wow. Look at that.
That is awesome.
Girl, I paid $1 for this.
Oh, don't that's you know? Cool. That's don't a good know? Collection.
Oh, is it? Wait. No. Hold on,
now, what
hold
else
hold
you got? You hold got hold some hold goodies.
I got some goodies. The Summer Olympics 1988 when Whitney Houston sang.
Oh, that's, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's got Whitney Houston, One Moment in Time.
Yes.
It's got all of those good ones.
Oh, my God. Do you know that Whitney is going into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but also she got another, they call it a diamond.
Mm.
I'm trying to think, is it the soundtrack from, what was the movie she was in with Kevin Costner?
The
Bodyguard.
Bodyguard, that's it. I hated the way that movie ended. They should have been
I
together.
Hate it. It sucked.
They should have been together.
Yeah, I think so.
I think they so was, too.
Yeah.
You know, Jungle Fever wasn't that big back then.
Yeah. She got the diamond. I think she got another diamond because her records are still selling.
Yeah, of course. You know? She's a legend. She would go hundreds of years beyond her existence.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. But mm-hmm. she comes from a family of singers, including her mother, mm-hmm. Dionne Warwick and Dee Dee Warwick.
Right.
They all were ahead of the time. Mm-hmm. They were very ahead of
very,
their time.
Very
and in fact,
so.
Dionne's sister, Dee Dee, mm-hmm. was a hell of a singer.
Mm-hmm.
Dee Dee
mm-hmm.
Warwick. You
wow.
listen to some of her stuff,
mm-hmm.
and her voice just leaps and bounds. You know what I'm saying?
I know. Yeah. I know. So yeah. this is the goal. Now I have another one with the twins back from the Bronx. Remember the twins? They were rappers and they had like this. It's in there somewhere. I can't find it. It's probably in the bottom,
uh-huh.
underneath the Time Life stuff.
Okay.
I had to.
Time Life of hip hop. I'm waiting for that.
But listen to this. They have to. Okay, so remember this one?
Oh, yes. What?
That, I got this.
Me?
I'm not kidding you.
Yes.
I got that, Dougie Fresh, and the crew. I got right. both of them, baby.
Oh, wow.
Both of
yes.
them.
Yes. And you know what's
and
funny?
It was under Reality Records. Remember that?
Yes. Listen, A lot of those if you really talking about hip hop, a lot of these records were produced in Harlem.
Oh yeah. In the closet, some of them.
Yeah.
And in the under bathroom.
Bobby Robinson, used to have the record shop down there in Harlem. Because you know, Bobby Robinson goes way back to the 50s, to the early 50s. But people like the Treacherous Three, Spoonie G, even Grandmaster Flash, they records.
Oh yes, oh yes. Right? You talking yeah. now. Keep talking.
You know what I'm saying? You had Paul Winley, he had his record company down there on 125th Street. You know, a lot of your even with Dougie Fresh, Teddy Riley, music behind Dougie Fresh. So, you know, I got a lot of those records. I have, like, when Grandmaster Flash did their first record, was Super Rapping.
Yeah.
Right?
Ooh, child.
That was on one label. Then they got a deal with Bobby Robinson label on Enjoy. Then they went on to Sugar Hill. You know what I'm saying? Before Sugar Hill, there was Enjoy Records, Paul Winley Records. You know what I'm saying? And they were the ones that had bands backing up these rappers.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. That was unheard of, too.
Yeah, it was. And it was good. It was great. Unheard of. Before the drum machines and the synthesizers, you had guys backing them up, bands backing them up.
That's right.
Pumpkin and the crew. They would be backing them up.
Yep.
And you heard some really boss records coming out of, you know, Harlem.
Oh yeah. You know, and it was so cool too, you know, in that time in the 80s and the late 70s, when rap really started to gain exposure and get out there, a lot of people were looking at it like, oh, they were ripping off of the pastor or the preacher, and they were coming out of the church, and that's how they learned. But it wasn't always necessarily that. You know, rap has always been around. Yes. It was just underground, you know what I mean? But it was brought out to the forefront.
Right. A lot of your disc jockeys from the 50s and 60s, like Jocko Henderson from Philadelphia, he started rapping on records. He would, you know, do like his little flavor while the record was playing. And a lot of this probably goes back even further than that. But hip hop is an original black art form.
Yes,
it is. Just like jazz. You know what I'm saying? And nobody knew that hip hop would now be the new rock and roll.
Right.
It really is.
Yeah, it is. Definitely. People, that's from the devil. That's from the devil. That's from rock and roll was from the devil.
Listen, white kids would come to our neighborhoods, come to our clubs.
And get rhythm. I'm sorry.
Right. Or come. Or
they would.
And listen.
Yeah.
And take it back to their community.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Yep. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's always been our history.
Right.
You know, R&B always will be the backbone of the music industry.
Yes.
The music industry makes a lot of their money off of us.
Yes, they do.
Okay?
Yes,
it's been
they
that
do.
Way for eons.
Yes, yes. And they've always taken our music.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. They've always taken our music. And I'm not going to name any names, but we already know. You close your eyes, and you can't tell whether they're white or black because they're singing the soul that they heard from the black community.
Now listen, when your mom was singing in the 80s, right? There was a period a little bit before it where they were trashing disco.
Right.
Right? They had this thing, they was in the stadium and they were saying burn disco.
Yeah.
Right?
But and then High Energy came out and they loved it.
And they loved it because they changed the name.
Right.
Instead of calling it disco.
Disco, they called it High Energy.
Right.
And that's why they called my mom the Queen of High Energy because it changed the whole outlook of dance music.
Of dance music.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at, you listen to disco, right? You had First Choice, right? The Tramps.
Yeah.
Right? You had South Shore Commission. Mm-hmm. People that was on the Philadelphia record labels. They called it disco, but it was still R&B.
It was.
Okay. Now, when you started getting long playing R&B was way before disco. That was like in the early 70s. You started seeing long form music. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the term disco comes from the word discotheque. Mm-hmm. Now, discotheques existed in the 60s.
Right.
Okay. Where you would go to the club and you would hear records that you normally wouldn't hear on the radio. And that whole groove stayed. And then when they realized they had something there, because remember, a lot of the black music in the clubs was played in the gay clubs.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Studio 54 and places like
that's
that.
That's right.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Paradise Garage, Better Days, all of these places played black music.
Right.
And that's when you started seeing long form music, mean long time music, people dancing for a long, you know, long time and everything. But still, black music was the backbone of that movement.
It was. And still is.
And still is.
And still is. It still is. Yeah. You know, you just don't have as many black players as you would think out there. I mean, there's some black iconic singers out there. Right. But it's not as it was in the past. It's not as it was.
Well, what I would do say, like going forward, you got more of us in terms of African-Americans and blacks in the world. We're starting to do more independent.
Right.
That we're taking possession of our art form.
Yes.
And to me, it's long overdue.
Yeah, definitely.
Because really, the model and the pattern of the music industry, you know, and I'm sure you heard stories from your mom.
Oh my gosh, yes. And from other, and many other artists. Because my mom didn't start in the 80s. She actually started in the 70s.
Right.
I was born in 72. Okay. And in 73, she had her first hit.
Okay.
Europe and had to leave me. I was 6 months old. She left and went on her first major tour at 19 years old.
Wow. I believe it. I believe it. You know, a lot of the pioneers like your mom and Gloria Gaynor, Carol Douglas.
I miss Gloria.
Yeah.
Her and my mom used to go out together, not to backtrack, but she used to go out together.
Okay.
And Gloria knew me since I was 7.
Wow.
Yeah.
And you know, I remember that song she came out with, it's called Honey Bee, right? That's way back. We talk about way back. But this is that music that your mom, Gloria Gaynor, Carol Douglas, Donna Summer, Fonda Rae, all of these people, even the lady that sang in Dr. Buzzards,
and don't forget
Band.
Sylvester was always on tour with them. Always.
Listen, this is the stuff that was in the gay clubs. You know what I'm saying? Before it became popular.
Right.
Okay.
And that's how she got discovered. Earth, Wind, and Fire actually got discovered from a club as well. Back in the day, the A&Rs used to go back to the clubs because that's where you would find the most, you know, the most talent. They would go to clubs. Now they don't even go to the clubs. Yes. What's in the clubs except the DJ?
That's right. Because the DJ, you know, kind of took the place. But, you know,
because
but
they're cheaper.
Yeah. But you're cheaper. Right. And a lot, and you know, if you look at the history of, like, if you ever see, there's this show that talks about in California when New York white artists from the folk era, they went to California and they performed at clubs like the Whiskey or Go-Go, all these different places on Sunset Strip. They were discovered by A&R. A&R would be at those clubs.
Yep.
That's how the Doors got discovered. That's how, you know, Mamas and the Papas.
Yep.
All these different groups got discovered at these folky clubs in the village and also in California.
And Chicago.
And Chicago. And the
underground blues clubs.
That's right. Absolutely.
You know, because that's where we're from. I'm from Chicago. And blues in Chicago was amazing. My grandmother loved blues. My great-grandmother, she's actually my great-grandmother. My great-grandmother loved blues. And so when my mom used to go and she used to take care of me, so She used to put me under the tables, you know, those high top tables.
Yeah.
They're really tight. So she would go in and cover it up with like big curtains and then put pillows and stuff down there. Nobody knew I was down there. I love blues. She had chips and drinks and stuff down there, my favorite toys. And I would sit there. I didn't know who was there. It could have been B.B. King for all I knew. Absolutely. But it was one of those things that I grew up on, going to the blues club at the age of like, I couldn't remember. Yeah.
So it's in your blood.
Yes, it is. Yes, it
it's
is.
It's in your blood.
You yeah, know? Definitely. And being that it's not just my mother. So my father's side is the McFerrin. So that's Bobby McFerrin as well.
Okay.
So it's like, it's just, it's all in there. It's all in there. And you know, you get the whole McFerrin family together and you're not unique, darling. You're not. Okay. Everybody can do what Bobby does, but they choose not to do it.
I got you.
They choose to go a different route. Everybody has their own thing they want to do. You know, and so it's it's definitely something that wow, you girl, you took me down memory lane, but I had to show you the records because I listen, girl.
I like that you still got your records because I still keep some of the first rap records that I ever bought. Because I used to go record shopping. You know, I used to live in the South Bronx.
Right.
And one of the things that we would do, because I started DJing like around 12. And usually guys was doing that. There wasn't really no females, you know, DJing like that. But, you know, that's how I learned. And also my father, you know, he was a avid record collector. So a lot of the music that I got exposed to was from him. Because he was, you know, my father comes from South Carolina. And he wanted to be a trumpet player like Miles Davis.
Oh, Miles Davis,
He came up to New York when he was 16. And, you know, some of the music that he was influenced by was like Miles. He was influenced by John Coltrane. He was influenced by Billie Holiday. He also listened to Cuban music. Because, you know, back in those days in the Bronx, we were known for the cha-cha-cha. And the mambo. So the history of like salsa comes from the Bronx. Because a lot of the dance halls, there was this place called Hunts Point Palace. And you would see Tito Puente, Tito Rodriguez. You would see all these people perform. And my parents used to go. They used to go to these places in the Bronx. And, you know, with the influence of Puerto Ricans in terms of their influence on the Bronx has a lot to do with it. You know, we had, I grew up listening to Spanish music.
Me too.
So, you know what I'm saying? So,
especially Suavemente Besame.
Listen, we was dancing to, there's a singer, she's before, I'm thinking of the singer. It'll come to me, but La Lupe, right?
Celia Cruz?
Celia Cruz.
La Lupe
was before Celia Cruz. So La Lupe used to work with Tito Puente. But if you, Celia, she stands out by herself.
God
bless her. But La Lupe, if you look at the history of La Lupe, get a chance, listen to La Lupe. Because it's like she's singing opera. But she still got that down home, like that, that soul in her gut when she sings, you know? So, and also El Gran Combo, we heard all of that. You know, so I grew up listening to all of that, you know, and also, you know, salsa and soul is called Latin Boogaloo. So I grew up hearing Latin Boogaloo. Up, you know, here in the Bronx. So with that, with the jazz, you know, and then you have hip hop, and then my father listened to Motown, and then we also listened to Chicago soul because we were big on that, you know, because they would tell me like when Curtis Mayfield or the Five Stair Steps would come, or Fontella Bass, you know, all of the Chess soul singers, G Chandler, all of them used to come to New York to perform at the Fox Theater in Brooklyn. You know what I mean? Or to the Apollo Theater.
That's right.
So we were influenced by that. And also James Brown, you know, all of that I think I went to my first concert at the Apollo. Was Gladys Knight, Stevie Wonder.
What?
And Denise LaSalle.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, so you had the blues, you had Motown, you know what I'm saying? Combined, they were all on the same ticket. I think Stevie was like 20, 22, 21, wow. 22, 23 at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so my parents used to take me to the Apollo Theater, and I remember, I think my girlfriend and I, we went to see the Silvers.
Mm-hmm.
The Silvers performed at the, you know, Madison Square Garden, called it the Felt Forum. Mm-hmm. So they performed there because I was big on the Silvers, but that was the bubblegum side of the Silvers. But if you listen to the Silvers, you listen to their first three albums, they were killer. Mm-hmm. In fact, they were better than the Jackson 5, actually.
Wow.
Vocally.
Wow.
See, the Jackson 5, I give it to them. I love them. They were precision. They were part of the Motown tradition, right. Mm-hmm. of training of dancers and singers together, choreography. They had right. that. Mm-hmm. But if you wanted to hear musically, it was the Silvers.
Hmm. Okay? Wow.
And before the Silvers, the Five Stair Steps.
Right. Of course. Yes. Definitely.
And they were not only gifted vocally, but they were gifted musicians also.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. You know, wow.
So, yeah.
So much history. So much. I mean, so much. You know, my husband's Cuban, and he was like, "Yeah, you know, if you're in New York, if you live in the Bronx, and you don't know
right.
Spanish, no matter what color you are,
that's
you
right.
are missing out, because that's like the predominant language of the Bronx. It's like
is.
Spanish.
It's been,
you know,
it's been the language of the Bronx, because I mean, they said." Because my parents, we come from Hunts Point,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of blacks had moved to Hunts Point. Really, a lot of white people used to live there. You know what I mean? But then when blacks came up from the South, they moved to the Bronx. And then when Puerto Ricans came from Puerto Rico, they came to the Bronx. Mm-hmm. And I think you started seeing more, like they say, the influx of Puerto Ricans was like 1948, 1949. Mm-hmm. You know, in the Bronx. And I wouldn't be surprised that the history of salsa is right there. I'm not surprised.
I know, that's right. And you know what? Then we always said that all the white people moved to Jersey. They moved to Jersey. Jersey. Jersey.
No, you know what it was? Is that, you know, the migration of blacks is funny even in New York, because, you know, if you came from Harlem and you got a house, you moved to Queens.
Mm-hmm.
Or you move to Brooklyn.
That's right.
Right? Mm-hmm. Move from the projects.
Mm-hmm.
You get a house uptown, even here to the Bronx, or to the yep. Valley, or whatever. Mm-hmm.
Of the Valley.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times that migration, the white people started moving further up, or they went to Co-op City, which is funny.
Or Maine.
Right. Now, I now live in Co-op City, but when I was a kid, that was like, what the hell is Co-op City? What is that? Because mostly white people lived here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you had some blacks, and I had a lady that my mother used to work with. They lived here in the 70s, right? But we wasn't even thinking about Co-op City. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's funny, I live here now.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But that's how it is. You know what I'm saying?
It's,
you know, and there's a lot of history as far as hip hop with the Bronx.
I know.
It's legendary.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
How
it has spread and caught on fire in other boroughs,
right?
As well, and then all over the country, and then in the world. You know?
Yeah. And I mean, but if you live in New York, if you lived anywhere in New York, you lived in all five boroughs. I'm not gonna lie to you. You had to. You have to experience all of them.
Yeah. You do. Yeah,
you
do.
You have to. You
know?
You just can't like live in Manhattan and not go to Brooklyn.
Well, that's true.
You know,
but
you can't.
You know, it's funny, I lived in Brooklyn,
mm-hmm.
but people from the Bronx, oh, you live all the way down there? I'm not coming there, right? So I'm in the Bronx.
But the train goes right underground. It's like right under some of the buildings, and you could go right up the stairs into the building.
Listen,
you know, it's like, it's so convenient. So why not go there? You hop on the train, you don't even need a car.
But you know what's funny? I didn't start meeting, like, finding out Brooklyn flavor in terms of music until I met people from Brooklyn. You know what I'm saying? So when I went to high school, I have friends from Brooklyn. So when I started going to Brooklyn, I was listening to some different type of hip hop. It was like gangsta. You know what I'm saying?
I know.
It was like harder. It was like real hard. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, then when you go to Harlem, see, Harlem had the gangster edge, but there was the dances. A lot of your dances came out of Harlem.
Yeah, yeah. You know what I'm saying? That's creativity. They had all different kind of dance schools there, so it wasn't as hard as it was back in, you know, like like South Bronx, where, you know, Boogie Down, South Bronx, you know.
Listen, when you hear dance records from back in the days, like the 70s and 80s, a lot of the dance, like, this is a song called Do the Wop. The Wop came from Harlem. So any dances that you needed to learn, you had to go to Harlem to learn.
You did. That's right. That's right. I had friends of mine that lived out in Harlem, and I used to go out there like at least once a month. About get the cardboard out, okay? Because we were breakdancing.
Yes, that's right.
It was just down. Definitely. You had your beatbox, just like LL said.
That's right.
I can't live without my radio. That's what it was about. It was like, you know, you go to the corner.
That's right.
You got all your friends.
That's right.
You got your cardboard.
Yes.
You got your hat because you're gonna use that as a mitt.
That's right.
I remember all of that.
Yes. So it was, but you were exposed, and you were exposed to a lot of music, even house music, which I was amazed with house music because the origins of house, I always say, is Chicago and Detroit.
Yes. You
know, house music.
And that's where my mom started. My mom started with house music. Scene. Yeah.
Yes. And to me, when house music came to New York, I was like, what? Listen, you couldn't get me out. Get me out the club because the music was too good. You know, that's where I heard, you know, in the clubs, that's where I heard house music. And then once I started going to gay clubs, I was like, whoa, you know what I'm saying? So they was playing all these R&B classics.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And I was like, whoa.
And they were changing the music too. So some of it was R&B. And then all of a sudden you hear the house version. And that sucker's like 16 minutes long. And you're on the dance floor. You don't even realize you've been dancing for 16 minutes.
That's right. Listen, that's just what it is. And that's how you get exposed to the different types of music. You know, it's like I used to go to this place called Silver Shadow. Mm-hmm. Used to be on 57th and 7th Avenue, between 6th and 7th Avenue. And when you went in there, you got dressed up, okay? This is like the 80s now. We dressed back in those days.
Mm-hmm.
And when we would go in those clubs, you know, the guys was dressed. They had their suits, three-piece suits. And let me tell you, some of the music that was coming out of those clubs.
You couldn't hear on the radio?
No, not at all.
You had to go
to a record store to get the 12-inch.
Side B.
That's what I had to do. Yeah.
Side B. Usually side B was the hit. Yeah. Everybody looks at side A, but let's listen to side B.
And I'm glad you say that because, you know, I'm a musician and I play in a rock band, right?
Mm.
So my bandmate, he likes to play the hot rock hits.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to tell him, listen, there's some B-sides that people know.
Mm-hmm.
And slowly he started to come around. We started doing some B-side stuff.
Right.
Even rock B-sides.
And that's, you know, you have to, because as a band, you have to set your part. You have to set yourself apart as being unique.
That's
and you
right.
don't want to be playing what somebody heard last night.
That's right. Exactly.
Yeah.
See, he likes music from his era, which is really our era. You know, I'm only like a few years older than him, but he likes that rock music from the 80s and the 90s. And I said, listen, some people like some 70s stuff. They might want to hear some 60s.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? They might want to hear a little bit of R&B.
That's right.
Might want to hear a little bit of reggae. You know what I'm saying? You gotta mix it up. You know
my favorite rock band is Aerosmith.
Really?
Yeah. I know I don't look like an Aerosmith girl, but I am. I am definitely Steven Tyler. Cool. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Love Aerosmith.
Listen,
love Aerosmith.
My band that I like is Rolling Stones. Because I always liked them. Plus,
I like them when he dances.
Listen, he got so much soul in that little skinny body.
And you know, he's still doing it.
Yeah, he's still doing it.
How does he get the energy? I need some of that.
I don't know.
I need
some of that energy. And he had heart surgery recently.
Wow.
you know. But Mick Jagger and the Rolling Stones, they, you know, listen, they just, one thing about the British invasion, they basically reintroduced R&B to everybody.
Right. And the love of music. The love of, right. Because, man, Europeans love music. They love music even more. Like, if you were, if you were to go right now overseas, you would be huge.
Listen, they listening, they listening to me overseas.
See?
You know what I'm saying? Because especially in Germany, in England and France.
Right.
And you know what's crazy? In Russia. I was like, what? Russian Federation, Krasnodar, whatever. I'm like, what? But that shows you, and your mom could talk about that too, is that a lot of Black artists had to make their money overseas.
Yeah, and that's where she made her first hits.
Yeah.
Hyunji was the one that actually broke her in the United States. Wow. But she had she had Weak Spot. She had
Head in the Stars.
Remember that one? That was My Little Weak Spot. Yeah, yeah. So you got, you had that one. Yeah. You had Head in the Stars. We did Reflections of the Way Life Used to Be. I sound just like my mother. It's ridiculous. Anyway, so she's done all those. And then when High Energy came out, I'm going to tell you a story. We did, okay, so I was in, you know, I was in Europe with my mother. We were at the studio and they had this whole build for Reflections. So it was the stairs that led up. Now the stairs, my mom was very scared of the stairs because it didn't have a balcony. So if you're watching the music video for Reflections, she's actually sitting on the edge of a very high up thing that if she was to fall off, would be emergency room for her, basically. So she had to be like really, really not moving too much. So they did Reflections. They did the entire thing. They broke the set down. They still had time. So what they did was they took the top piece of the set. They put it on the ground.
Yeah.
And they said, we're going to do a video impromptu of High Energy. So back in the 80s, everybody had on their leg warmers and their, you know, so it's like, okay, so just guys, go get dressed or whatever you came with. Let's put the kids in the front of the stage. So here I am. I have on a blue sweater, a white, white ribbon in my hair that was made from some of the material that was left over from the set. Okay. blue Lee jeans. I was this skinny, this skinny, and they put me in front of the camera, and I went, and they said, "The girl is not shy." She says, "Oh, who? Her? No, she ain't shy." Got me up on the stage and everything, the producer's kids, and that was the video. And when you see it today, it's kind of like a time capsule for me. I was I think I was like 10 or 11 in that video.
I gotta look at that.
And you'll see me. You'll be like, that girl, she is so skinny.
So let me ask you, how did you like, you know, I saw in your bio that you sang with the ladies that were formerly of the Supremes.
Yeah, and thank you for saying it like that, because you know the technicalities of the whole thing. They're amazing women. Women. Sherry's amazing. They were all very welcoming to me. So what had happened was we found ourselves on the same roster as with Corey Kostler. He is he has a company that he has like all the oldies on his roster. And at that time we were singing with Glenn Leonard, the former tenor of the Temptations. And he was in Washington, and they were like, well, we need someone to open up for us, and he's like, I got the perfect person, she's already on my roster, I'm gonna call her and book her. And that's how that happened. And so that's opened up with the band I was with the Crashers at the time. And it was amazing. I got to go backstage, I got to watch them perform. I got to get some good advice. Like Sherry, she's always wanted to do theaters and write plays, and she's doing that now. So, you know, just like life doesn't end because you love music. There's always going to be something different that you love to do. And so these women are amazing.
Yeah, because Sherry, you know, she has a great history because she was in Glass House. And they had some hits on Hot Wax, produced by Holland Dozier and Holland. And
and that's the same guy that produced some of my mother's songs too. Yeah, Holland Dozier.
Yeah, because HDH, you know, they still going strong.
Yep.
And their history by itself is amazing because, you know, from them, you know, with, I think it was Eddie Holland.
Right.
Eddie Holland is a good singer.
Oh, yeah.
He sounded like Jackie Wilson. Mm-hmm. If you listen to his early records, and he had a hell of a voice, but he said he was shy. So,
you know what? It happens.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, you get this person, you put them on stage and mm-hmm. they become like this bright light. Yeah. And then all of a sudden mm-hmm. you get them behind the scenes and they're like, thank you.
You know, but you know, it's amazing when people talk about Michael Jackson.
No.
Michael Jackson, you wouldn't think that all this came out of him. He was very reserved.
And
guy.
What about Prince?
Yeah. What? Prince?
Prince ran. If he had any confrontations, I remember seeing him on, what was that, the show with the ladies around the table. I forgot what it was.
Oh, but you know what I'm talking about.
Yes. He went on that show. And remember when, what's her name, started, like, she sat next to him. He got up and left.
Yeah.
Like he was that. Like, oh, no.
He was like that. Yeah, he was like that. But he was just brilliant.
Oh, yeah.
You know what
I'm
saying? Just brilliant. You know, mm-hmm. but that's great that you got a chance to, you know, open, you know, for them, you know, that's, and you got some good experience with them because with Cherie and mm-hmm. Linda Lawrence and Suzanne Green and
amazing.
And the fact that, you know, if it wasn't for Mary Wilson, mm-hmm. the Supremes would have ended when Diana Ross left.
Yes, they would have. And the one friend of mine that's a really close friend of mine is Brenda Waddy, mm-hmm. and she sang with the Marvelettes, and she also sang with, of course, the lady from the Marvelettes. I forgot her name. Real quick.
Which one? Catherine Schaffner?
No. She actually sang with the former lady of the Supreme, the lady you just mentioned.
Oh, I can't Cherie. Think of
name. Right. And she also sang with them for 8 years. She was
But
you know, the one thing that she's always taught me was you just have to be yourself.
Yeah.
And people will love you for being yourself. And
that's
these women definitely they exude being themselves.
Yeah.
So I was so comfortable around them. They were so like, hey, you know, do your dream, go after it. You have an amazing voice. We love you, you know, and keep going. So, and fame, they talked about that with me. They said that fame is being famous is not necessarily what people would think it is. They said being famous is something that you have to define for yourself.
Yeah, you do.
You know, what is fame for you? Is fame for you being the best you can be? Reaching as many people as you can, but being true to yourself, what is fame to you? So it was wonderful just to meet them. I also got to meet Mary, who told me the same thing. It was amazing. I got to meet a lot of different people the music industry. I got one big thing from all of them. Mm-hmm. And the one big thing I got from them is just do what you love and be yourself.
Mm-hmm. Enjoy yourself. It's like my girlfriend, she's from the Bronx, mm-hmm. and she was a school teacher, but she decided to go down the path and be a singer. Mm-hmm. And she's a professional singer. She's been singing with the Crystals for about 15 years. Mm-hmm. And she sings with the original member of the Crystals that was produced by Phil Spector.
Oh, wow.
And they've traveled all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just so proud of her.
Yeah.
That she pursued her dream, and she was she got discovered by Smokey Robinson, actually. Smokey developed this play called Raising Hell.
Mm-hmm.
And they put the show on at the Billie Holiday Theater in Bedford-Stuyvesant, Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
And he casted her. She auditioned, mm-hmm. he casted her. And you know, after that, just she took off.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? And she says the same thing. The old timers give her good wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
The people that she's been surrounded that were in the industry for like 50 years, you know,
right.
told her, you know, how to handle herself, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Mm-hmm. You know, just the fact that we have all of these opportunities that come our way. And, you know, when it comes so fast.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it's over. And it's like, wow, I did that.
Yeah. And you can look back on your work that you've done. But, you know, a lot of your ancestors that came before you laid the groundwork.
They did the groundwork. And I'm very grateful.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, I did play a song you were on with Raymond Barton. On my show.
Thank you.
It's a nice song.
Did you like it?
Yeah, it's nice.
Love in Your Eyes. Yeah, it's gone through the first round of Grammy ballot. I'm not sure if it made it. I don't know.
It's all good.
It's simple.
I said, Yaya Diamond. I heard that name. Wait a minute. I said, this the same person? So I said, okay.
Yeah. You know, it's like, a really simple song. I like it. The simplicity of it. It takes you back to when love songs was just a memory of what was going on in that time. Right. You know, it was like the soundtrack to life, you know?
Well,
it's really nice.
Yeah, because I did a show where I was playing like all these black love songs that we had, man, from the Delphonics, Blue Magic, right? I even had the Modulations, Jimmy Briscoe, and the Little Beavers.
Mm.
They had this beautiful song called Ebony Princess. Mm-hmm. That's a gorgeous song.
Mm.
You're my Ebony Princess.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I thought that was beautiful. So, you know, we still need those love songs.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes. And simple. I love simple stuff, you know.
Yeah.
Things that you can actually sing along to.
Yeah.
And so to me, you know, when I used to try to sing along to Whitney Houston, this was not going to happen. So it was, you know, if the love songs were more simple, I can do that. So I really wanted to do a really simple love song, something kind of everybody can kind of, you know, relate to and sing along to and memorize it. And and that song, Loving Your Eyes, is something that's
pretty. It's beautiful. I was like, I like this.
Thank you. So I can definitely see why you're into music, why you love it so much. You know, what kind of advice do you give the people that are listening to all of the things that just happened? Because, I mean, we went down like memory lane here. It was so fun. I don't want to stop. But
you know what?
What kind of advice do you give them?
Listen to your music. Listen to your history. Because this is how we connect the dots. You know, you hear a lot of the pain, the struggles, the triumphs, and you enjoy it. And also, there are many people that you can listen to, study from. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes when I revisit some of these records, like if I listen to Otis Redding or if I listen to Aretha Franklin, especially before she became popular. Luther.
Even he wasn't even Luther Vandross. He was just Luther.
Right. Luther, yes.
Luther.
And when Luther used to sing backup for David Bowie, because he was a backup singer.
He was a backup singer.
Now, that's a whole other show we could talk about.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Because a lot of your singers, like Lisa Fisher, I love her, right? Mm-hmm. You know, listen, there's so many people that we need to revisit.
Right.
Even Sylvester. I'm amazed.
Let me tell you, Sylvester, and I just have to say this: he was so nice to me. My mom and them used to go out on tour together.
So
the Berlin Wall had not been taken down yet, and if you don't know about that, you need to go back into the history.
That's right.
So what the record label didn't want to do was send all of their artists over at one time. So they would send them in pieces. So when my mother would go over there, Sylvester, and they would take care of me. Him and Eartha would take care of me. Aww. And then with Eartha's kids back in those time. And then, or I would stay at the producer's house.
Okay.
But they took me shopping.
Nice.
We went to go see the changing of the guards. I mean, they took me everywhere. They kept all the kids busy. And then, so when my mother would come back, and then it would be a couple of other artists, maybe Michael Brown or somebody would come back.
Okay.
Then, so, you know, Sylvester and Eartha would go over and then we would take care. So it was kind of like, so it was a family. It was so cool.
Yeah.
And so Sylvester, not only did he touch me musically, because the man's voice, I mean, come on, who could get that high? You know, even and Grace Jones too. Now Grace,
yes, listen,
she was the sweetheart too. Come on now.
With Grace Jones, to me, what got me hooked on her was when she did La Vie en Rose. Not when she did Pull Up to the Bumper.
I love that song though. I'm sorry, I love that.
I love it too. Bumper, baby. But when she did Edith Piaf's song, yes, that made me cry.
Mm-hmm.
And I said,
yeah, because whoa, she's talented.
Yes.
But her thing is she's super tall and super slim and she's super dark. And listen, so she was like,
beautiful.
She was like, look, this is going to work for me. Listen. She's going to put this to work. She took advantage of her size,
listen,
her skin color,
listen,
and her
everything.
Slimness. She just,
everything
she did
about her. She mm-hmm. was the first Alec Weck model. You know Alec Weck, right?
Mm-mm, I didn't know.
Alec Weck.
I know she was a model.
She's okay, dark skin, beautiful. Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
Short hair.
Mm-hmm.
When Grace was rocking the fade.
Oh, yeah.
Before we all started rocking fades.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, listen. Grace Jones is forever a trendsetter.
Yes. Oh, yes.
I love her.
I love her. Yes. So it was Grace Jones and Sylvester. I know they went out a lot together.
Okay.
And Sylvester, what a voice. But you if you knew him behind the scenes, you would fall in love with him. Because he loved children.
Okay.
He loved children. He took care of me like I was his daughter. Kid.
Yeah.
That's and it touched me when he passed away.
Yeah.
You know, and even George Michael, because remember all these people toured together. So when George Michael, I can't really say too much, but I could say that before he passed away a year, we were supposed to see George Michael. I can't really say too much about it.
Right.
But then when he passed away, when he passed away, we were actually supposed to be going to Europe.
Oh.
And with my mom. Okay. Because I told her, I'm going to go with you this time because I want to see him. And he passed away right then and there. And so everything got canceled.
Yeah.
But, you know, these people, you don't realize that this is not just an artist that passes away. This is a friend.
Yeah.
It's a family member. It's people that helped me when I was 4 years old, you know, and I used to go in the dance crew. And that was the little girl that used to raise up and the little black girl that used to pick up during the concerts.
Yes.
That was me.
Okay.
That was me. That was that little girl that the blue and the black, was it the black man and the silver? It was a gold man and a silver man. It was always, and they used to pick me up and just toss me. And I was the one because I was so little. And, you know, so most people are like, that was you? Because they came to the concert back in the 70s, back in the
80s. That's right.
And so
they were
family.
Yeah.
The dancers, everybody. And it's sad.
It
does touch me a little bit still to this day.
Yeah. But just to listen to the music, listen to everything that is around you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, black people have really influenced culture.
Mm-hmm.
And whether it's dress, language, politics, whatever, but especially music.
Yeah.
And listen to what's around you. Listen to jazz. Mm. Listen to Afrobeat. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't start getting exposed to African music until my father had Miriam Makeba. And she did Xhosa. She was the click language in Pata Pata.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So listen to your diaspora's music.
That's
and I'm so happy to hear Afrobeat music come back.
Yes, yes, definitely.
Especially here. It's always been there, but it's back.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning it's influenced all types of music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so listen to all the variations of our music.
Yeah.
And we influence classical too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so listen to all of that. You know, it's not so much going down memory lane. You come from a very rich legacy.
Mm-hmm.
So why not soak it in? Everybody else soaks in your culture. Soak in your own culture.
That's it. That's it. You know, that's it. Wow. Well, thank you so much for being on the show, girl. I had such a good time.
You got some history, girl.
Oh.
You got some history yourself. You need to write a book.
That's what I keep telling me, but you know how much time I have to write a book?
Zero? Nah, you find a time.
I'm going to have to talk a book. Somebody type it?
Well, yeah, you can do that.
I'm actually in the process of doing one book, but it's a fiction, but I'm definitely going to be doing that. And, and definitely going to be writing down all of, it's like kind of like a memoir, basically. It's not like, it's and just, you know, going through all the travels, you know, being on the Autobahn and almost flipping over. I mean, remember back in the day, they didn't have that.
That's one place I want to check out.
Yo, but they have a speed limit now, so you can't really experience it like I did. Okay, they have a speed limit now. It's pretty fast. But what was happening was, if you were pulled over to the side of the road, because we were in the limo and the limo driver got lost. Okay, so we had to pull over to the side of the road. So we're on the side of the road. We pull over a little bit further over because, you know, it's the Autobahn. Okay, everybody's going like 100 miles or more.
That's what I hear.
So this truck goes by us, freaking limo goes whoop, boom. I was like, can we go now? My mom's like, calm down, baby, calm down. I'm like, no, mommy, I'm scared. I gotta go. We gotta go. Can we pull off? Can you do that somewhere else?
Oh wow. You know, that's crazy. How's your mom doing?
Oh, she's fine. She did an interview with Legends not too long ago. It's on YouTube.
Okay.
Yeah, so she's still doing her thing, you know what I mean? Good. But she kind of hides. Because she likes her privacy. My mother...
Well, I understand.
My mom, and most people don't know this, my mom started her career at 14.
Oh, wow.
Her first hit was at 19. And she's been going ever since. And she's almost 70.
Wow.
So, you know, most people don't realize how long my mom has been in the music industry. And starting at 14, singing in the club, singing like professionally at 14 years old.
Wow.
Most people don't realize it only took her 5 years to have her first major hit, which was Weak Spot, when she went back over to Europe to do it. And that was, I was born when she was 19. That was right after she gave birth to me. And she still got the little pouch. If you look at her in the music video, she's got the little birthing pouch still there. But she's got on her little jean outfit and she's singing. And it's like, I love my mom. She actually, she was a single mother. She raised me.
Okay.
She's an amazing job. You know, my dad, I knew my dad, but my mom had a career, and that's where she,
And that's where she wanted.
Yeah.
She wanted. Right. Mm-hmm. I understand that.
Yeah, you know, so I had a great co-parenting situation, and grandparents and that's godmother good. Who helped raise and stuff that's like good. That. So it was really good. It was really great. Mm-hmm.
You know, but I'm definitely, you know, I'm gonna switch roles and interview you. And
I'll have to be on your show, I guess.
Yes.
All right. Well, we can do that.
I'll let you know about that.
Oh yeah.
And
where can people find your show so that way they know?
Listen. They could check me out. I'm on PRN.FM at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So they just can go on the internet, do PRN.FM 6 o'clock on Fridays, do a new show every Friday. I also have my own radio network on the on Live 365. It's called the Bowl of Soul Mixed Stew Soul Music Radio Network, where I play nonstop R&B. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days of soul, right? Mm. And if they want to hear the podcast, they can go to abolasoul.com as well. And then look me up on Facebook. It's a Bowl of Soul, Mixed Stew of Soul Music Facebook page.
Awesome. We're going to have all that information in the description box below. Yeah. So if you're looking at this on either Amazon Fire or Roku, any of my stations, thank you so much for tuning in to the video portion as well as YouTube. You can always join, follow, sign up on Vimeo, Roku, Amazon Fire, and YouTube at Dream Chasers Radio or Yaya Diamond TV. If you're listening to us on a podcast, that means you got to jump over to the video, because a lot of this stuff you ain't seeing, and that's okay. Right. You didn't see it. But if you go to the video and you sign up, you'll see a lot of different things. You'll see a lot of different people. Oh, I had a great time.
I had a good time with
you. My gosh, I had a great time. You guys, thank you.
You taught me some stuff. That's what's up. You know.
Hey.
That's good. You come from a musical background yourself. So
yeah. I've done, you know what? If I look back on all the things that have happened in my life, I can't believe most of it. But I did it. Right. And I just kind of went with the flow. They were like, hey, you want to do this? I was like, yeah, okay. Listen, and then when it happened, I was like, I said yes. Okay.
Thank God. Right.
Yeah. Right. Here we go.
Going
you know,
up.
And there are thousands of people in the audience. And I said yes. And I was like, you know what? I always say to myself, you have 5 seconds to answer.
Okay.
That's right. My thing. You have 5 seconds to answer. Mm-hmm. Now, if you don't want to do it, you have 5 seconds to say no, but right. say no. Right. Don't say maybe.
Right.
Don't say I'll think about it.
Right.
It's no.
It's no.
It's right. no. But maybe next time.
But maybe next time.
That's However, right. you have 5 seconds to say yes. And if it's a major thing and you're really, really scared, I say jump into it. And when you get through with it, you will love yourself.
That's right.
So say yes.
Say yes. That's right. It's good, good advice.
Mm-hmm. Say yes. All right. So I will be on your show. I was excited.
Yes. That's what's up.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being on the show. Again, I love you. Don't go anywhere. And thank you guys for tuning in wherever you're tuning in. And don't forget to what? Dare to be different, baby. Until next time, guys. Bye. Don't you go nowhere, girl. Hold on a second. This is behind the scenes. Y'all ain't into this. Bye, y'all. Bye. I dare to be different.